This is a session. I called it PGP. It's not only a TCP session, yeah? Because PGP, who knows PGP? Who are the experts of PGP? Oh my gosh. One expert. I need more. Because when I was setting up this session, yeah, I was thinking, oh my gosh, what you have done, yeah? Submitted a topic, and someone, okay, and the audience can be more expert than I am, yeah? Because this is, PGP is for me only one protocol that Wireshark can dissect. And I will show some tricks and some hints, what I learned with Wireshark to extend my protocol knowledge. The reason for that is I'm configuring networks, yeah, more than a decade right now, yeah? And I have to capture it before and not after. I learned how to configure and how to use commands on different systems, but I never understand how that works really well, yeah? And when I captured something, yeah, or analyzed some capture files, oh, this is a point, this is a bit, all that. And then I got the clue, yeah? And I will show you a bit more in the next, I would say, 60 minutes, 75, it depends how fast I am, how I'm nervous or whatever, yeah? So come in, have a seat. First of all, there's some material. I put it on a cloud space, yeah? So you can download it. A lot of materials, a lot of RFCs, because I know you guys, you are traveling also a lot like me. You can read it on the airport or in the train, not reading when you're driving by car. And some capture files and something else, yeah? Yes, this is the old way in IPv4, yeah? Using a broadcast in IPv6. Broadcast, yeah? But I understand broadcast, yeah? Sorry for that, Herbert. Yeah, broadcast, yeah? You can using audio, yeah? Sometimes I use that also, yeah? I learned a lot when listening someone, and I'm listening not only once, I'm listening 4 or 5 times to get the key point, yeah? And broadcast. So please download this material, yeah? Hope it's a good collection for you, a lot of RFCs and so on else, yeah? Okay, this is our agenda for the next hour, I would say, yeah? And I used this Lego bricks, yeah? I forgot to make a copyright of Lego.com. That is my fault, yeah? I found it out afterwards because Lego is not so easy, yeah? Because I use a lot of picture of Lego in this. Because make it more entertaining you, because after lunch, yeah? I know that, yeah? So, history, RFCs, direction of further research, PGP notifications, authentication and security. Then 2 bytes versus 4 bytes. Who know the difference right now in PGP, 2 and 4 bytes, ASN? Anybody heard about it before? One? Okay, some hands rising, yeah. Communities, then PGP link signaling, yeah. Because PGP is a protocol that is on the market right now, very long, yeah. And you know why this protocol survived? Who have any clue of that? Why this protocol is so long in market right now? Anyone? Guys in the background, you can hear me? Okay, good. You have some clue why this protocol is so long?
It's
stable is 1 point, yeah?
Good enough.
Good enough is another point?
It has been extended to carry out
all the protocols. That is the key point. It's extendable. And extendable by type length value. And each protocol that is extendable will be survived. I give you another example of a protocol. It's like the link layer discovery protocol. It's in layer 2 control protocol, but you can extend it by type length value. And each protocol you can extend will survive. This is my statement. Think about it, yeah? You have some proprietary protocols, for example, yeah, from vendor to vendor, which are not extendable. and these protocols are not survived. I give you an example for OSPF version 2. For IPv6, you need OSPF version 3, because OSPF version 2 is not extendable in comparison to ISIS. But we are not talking about IGP, we are talking about PGP. Yeah? Okay, coming back to the agenda. This is a very good topic right now, PGP EVPN. Who of you guys use PGP EVPN? Not in protection? Oh, the expert use it, yeah? Anyone else? PGP EVPN? This is the protocol right now. Where you use it, for example? Yes, data center. This is a key point, yeah? PGP EVPN used everywhere in data centers right now. I would call it in the cloud. But data center on-premise, off-premise, you have to defer it, yeah? Then PGP graceful restart, also a feature I found out sometimes very useful. Sometimes I have challenges with different vendors. Vendor A and vendor B are not working together. That's the point. And to close up this session, I found out when I prepared this session for the SharkFest US, I found out some network engineers playing with PGP over the internet and making some funny things. Maybe you have, oh, you know it? Yes, that's a good thing, yeah? Okay, this is about me, you can read it afterwards. Histories and RFCs, yeah? The most important RFC you should read is RFC 1925. Who knows this RFC? Ah, yes. The 12 networking rules, yeah? And what was the first point of RFC 1925? You remember also, maybe?
Yeah, I only remember 11.
11, okay. What was that?
There's no new stuff. Everything has been there already.
Okay. So I think you guys connected to internet, have a look. What is the first item of RFC 1925? Who found it? The guy in the background, can you tell? It has to work. That's so important. We are lowering right now, but it has to work. And when you troubleshoot with Wireshark, yeah, it has to work. You find out the key point, what's going wrong, yeah? Okay. This is PGP in the first days. Like you guys, these guys on a meeting, I think it was an IETF meeting or something, they wrote it down on a napkin, the protocol specification of PGP. For the guys in the background or in the front, it's not easy to read it, but here you have some state diagram, then you have here defined how many bytes, and here, maybe you can see it in the front here, the different message type of PGP. Wrote it down on a napkin. 3 pages. And you see, this protocol survived. And this napkin, or a copy of this napkin, have been stored in the Computer History Museum. And when I gave that talk last time in the Computer History Museum, I was impressed. I'm coming back to the place where the napkin or the copy of the napkin are be stored, yeah? Amazing, yeah? Okay, what is PGP? You can read it. You have heard about this here, Border Gateway Protocol. And sometimes you hear PGP version 1. Anybody have heard about PGP version 1, 2, 3? Long time ago, huh? Maybe some more experienced guys in the background. You have heard about PGP version 3, 4? That's important there, yeah, because PGP version 4 was the first version. You can use it variable subnet mask. Before, you have only classful routing with PGP. Yeah? In the old days, class A, B, C for IPv4. Yeah? it's not so chatty. It's a TCP session, sync, sync, ACK, ACK. You have learned a lot of TCP right now, yeah? I was impressed in a session in the morning of this guy from the Ukraine, Vladimir. That was a TCP session like, I was, oh my gosh. This guy was prepared over a year, yeah, this session. I motivated him and said, Vlad, next year you will stand also here in front and present like the audience, like you guys in front, yeah? And he did a very good job, yeah? So BGP, everyone can speak it, yeah? It doesn't depend on network vendor. Also some software vendor use it right now. For example, Microsoft used it also in the data center with Windows Server 2019, yeah? Or 2016, or before also, yeah? And BGP is a multi-protocol. It doesn't not only route prefixes from IPv4. IPv4 is one address family. IPv6 is another one. And in data center right now, you will route, for example, MAC addresses or MPLS labels or whatever, yeah? So the protocol is very extendable, yeah? Who have seen this drawing in real life? Some guys, where you saw it?
From RIPE.
From RIPE is something, yeah, some tools. BGP Mon or BGP Play, yeah, different tools available, yeah. And what you are seeing here, these are the autonomous system numbers, ASN, yeah. So, and these numbers can be 2-byte or 4-byte, yeah. And you see how this AS number is peering with this number and blah, 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 yeah. So you see all the connections, they hold the networks together. Sometimes I read holding the internet together, but BGP also used in internal networks, yeah? And then what's happened with BGP? Sometimes it's be hijacked. Is that good, bad? It's up to you, yeah? And when BGP is used to steal something, at the end of the day, it means they will stolen some money, for example, yeah? And then cryptocurrency, I was confused when I read that the first time, what had such to do with BGP? The security of BGP, yeah? And when you think about that, yeah? I found that somewhere around the world, yeah, with love and Bitcoin, but has nothing to do with BGP, but Bitcoin, yeah? The currency of crypto, yeah? So, this RFC, yeah, very dry. Reading some RFC, yeah, you can do it. This is a screenshot I got from another analyzer than Wireshark. I have to switch between the PGP versions, yeah? PGP version 3 or version 4. In Wireshark, you have not this option anymore, yeah? This is an old-time analyzer, yeah? It was proprietary analyzer, but very good also one, yeah? These are the lot of RFCs here. And when you read that RFCs, you need a lot of time. Who is reading RFCs, by the way? One, two, okay, a few guys. Is that boring? Sometimes, huh? Depends, is the answer always, yeah? So, PGP is defined in 1771. This is PGP version 4. Then extension to all these RFCs. But this RFC, you should be deal with it when you have something with PGP in your mind, yeah? And I put it all on this share, on this cloud share. So you can read it offline. This is also important, yeah? You should store some materials offline. Because when you have a network outage, like a network who is supported with PGP or whatever, yeah, you can read it offline. This is a good advice. Make a baselining and do something offline. Okay, too much RFCs, I would say, yeah, because I will not bring it up each RFC. Too much? Only for your reference here, yeah? Oh, yeah? Okay, let's go. Okay, another one. So much here. Oh, never stops. Huh? Okay, I think we'll stop. Okay. So, this sharks here. How you can find further information of PGP. RFC is one. Who know another source? When you're reading something about protocols. After lunch. IETF, yeah. Some meetings like the SharkFest conference, yeah. You got some input. IETF, IANA. Who knows IANA? Oh, more hands right now. Huh? You're reading something of IANA? All these parameters are stored by IANA documents, yeah. I put it also on the share. And another source, who use it? Bugs.wireshark.org for research. No hands? Oh my gosh. But you all know this URL, or? Who put it here, PGP, in? Not before this session, maybe afterwards? How many counts you got on PGP? Can you do it right now? And you should use it as your, also a source of your information, yeah? How many bugs, solved, unsolved, or whatever, yeah, you found on PGP, yeah? For me, I'm not using this tool so often. Sometimes, okay, Wireshark clicking here, status unconfirmed, confirmed, blah, 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 and then fixed, not a bug, and so on. Who got a number for me right now? How many bugs you found? No one? Who's searching for? So many laptops on? Network is slow. Oh my gosh. So we are here for routing some prefixes or talking about prefix and not network performance, yeah? Because network performance means line rate for me, yeah? But this is a control protocol and not a data protocol, yeah? Okay. Slow network again? Two? These are the bugs. They are still open, maybe, or? In progress, yeah? That means you have to be careful what you are searching for, yeah? Like this one here, yeah? Confirmed and so on, yeah? And you use, advice from my side is, please use the advanced search here, yeah? And not the simple search. So, for BGP, options, you know where you navigate on the Wireshark to get this screenshot? Everyone know it? Right click on PGP and then context menu. It's the easiest way, yeah? So you see, reassemble PGP messages because it's TCP and can be fragmented, yeah? That can be an issue sometimes. This one here, yeah? And then the TCP port 179 and the autonomous number, yeah? Auto detection or 2-byte or 4-byte, yeah? And what's happened when one speaker is using 4-byte and the other speaker is using 2-byte? Okay, I will show you later on. Then, what I can advise you, use the display filter expression. Why is it so important? This is the field I learned a lot of protocols in Wireshark or with the tool Wireshark. Yeah? I got on this item and have a look in Wireshark on the left corner. Is it a predefined value of the field? And I copy that, the field name, and copy it and put it into the display filter expression. And then I see, okay, which other fields are there, and what is the length of the field, and what is the meaning sometimes of the field, yeah? That helps also a lot. I will show you maybe live, yeah? some AS number are private for 2-byte ASN and also for the 4-byte ASN. So when you see sometimes documentation, yeah, AS number 65400, for example, yeah, this is a private ISN number, yeah. So IANA.org assignments, when the internet is working better right now, you can have a look on it, yeah. Okay, let's start with BGP notification. What that means for that, yeah? The speaker notify another one, maybe some compatibility or incompatibility, yeah, of that. So I use this display filter expression, the field name, BGP point notify minor underscore error or major underscore error. And I use Wireshark. Okay, what are the options? The one option is message header error, open message error, and so on. And I ask every item what that means here. And this is how I extend my knowledge with each protocol. I clicked to this here, peer deconfigured. What that means in real life. And then going back to RFCs and reading that, searching that, yeah, control F on my Windows system, yeah, or Unix system, whatever, grab some RFCs. What is that meaning? And reading again, yeah. So each item, I use it. Okay, finite state machine error. What that means? FSM error, yeah. Or cheese. Who have heard about this one? What that means? It's a good exercise for you afterwards. Have a search on the RFCs, yeah. You know how to search different PDFs, yeah? In one click. And then you can find it, yeah? What that means, yeah. So the notification, yeah, message, hold timer expired, yeah, is one of them, yeah. Another one is this cheese, yeah, administratively reset. Another one is other configuration change, yeah. Or last gateway of resort, I don't know, unknown. The point is, when you have different things, yeah, to capture, have a look on the different option or the different values that can be represented in each protocol, yeah? And ask yourself, what is the meaning of that, yeah? And what I learned, yeah, I was, I think last year, or was it 2 years ago in SharkFest Europe also with Sake, we had industrial communication guys speaking about Modbus or whatever, and I told them, yeah, you can use the display filter expression to see what is predefined on the dissector. It depends on the dissector, how good or bad is written sometimes, yeah? Sometimes the guy who wrote a dissector, they're only doing a copy-paste one time, so this is a lazy way. Right now, they do it automatically, when you have heard about that in the keynote from Gerald. They do it from ASN and build the dissector dynamically and not copy-paste. So it depends how the dissector, the quality of the dissector is it, yeah? And this display filter expression helps me a lot to extend, yeah? I can encourage you to use it also, yeah? Copy, paste, and bring it into the search boxes, whatever, yeah? The hard way is, and I show you that also, to read the dissector, the C code of the dissector in clear text, because it's C-based, and then you can search the dissector, yeah? Let me show you that. So everyone from you have used this dissector? Let me check. This EPAN, yeah, underscore dissectors, underscore packet, dash, BGP point C, yeah. Search for packet, dash, BGP point C, yeah. you can browse the source code. Who have done that? Also, besides the developers, they know every file in my mind. From a user experience, who have done this, searching on the source code, some guy. There are a lot of information sometimes in the dissector. And here you found also, that was the motivation of all these RFCs, yeah? I copy-paste these RFCs, I'm lazy, yeah, by the way. And then you see, let me check. And you see here, this type that are defined on the napkin, yeah? You find it here in the source code of Wireshark, yeah? Okay, two types are not there, because the napkin 20 years, 25 years old. But capability and route refresh was not said. There were only four types defined on the napkin, but it's extendable, yeah? Because you have one byte, and with one byte, you have 8-bit. 2 to the power of 8 means 256 different values, yeah, can be supported, yeah, of message type, yeah? And what the developers sometimes do, they make some comments into the dissector. Who have been there in Laura's class? Of you guys? Few hands? Oh, half of it? 30%? Half of it? There's the DCP dissector. They have also a lot of comments there, yeah? And I think Laura mentioned that also. Yes? And that I learned from Laura also. Have a look on the PGP dissector and see what's on the comments in the PGP, yeah? And you found sometimes in the dissector very good information, yeah? And this dissector, let me check. Oops. Have 10K, yeah, for one protocol. How many protocols? I think Gerald presented on the keynote also, how many protocols Wireshark can dissect right now? Yeah, 2.5K. So how many lines of code? There was a question mark on the slide of Gerard. You know how million lines of code Wireshark? 3.5, 2.5 million, huh? Depends, yeah, it was a question mark. Yeah? And in comparison to the source code of the whole Wireshark, to this protocol, yeah, the ratio is normal, I would say, yeah. I know some dissector, for example, for the SNMP or for the telecom stuff, a huge of dissector or the LDAP dissector, yeah. There is a reason why they are using it right now automatically, yeah. Because by hand you cannot do it, yeah. Okay, coming back. So for notification, yeah, it's also important. This is the Wireshark hex code, yeah? And I was surprised, yeah, that the message is represented in ASCII-2 here. Peer deconfigured, yeah? It's not only a value, it's an ASCII-2, yeah? And I was reading that why this protocol specification say it in such way, it's ASCII-2, and not only a value, yeah, like an integer value, yeah? And I was reading and asking myself, what's going on with this guy when they make this standard, yeah? It's also sometimes some guy not showing the hex value, or you can impress your boss, yeah, switching from hex to zeros and ones. We have done that. You know that? I will show you in Wireshark. And then you can read, okay, this bit and that bit, okay. Flip that bit, okay, boss, I found it. The golden bit here. Yeah. And then you impressed your boss, and then switching back to hex, using as were normal, yeah? Okay. And then sometimes I found the notification, no add-on, and some other frame have an add-on. And I was reading, okay, what is this in this add-on here? This capability here is an add-on. Some vendor use it, some vendor don't use it. And you have to compare two frames. Who of this expert knows how to compare two frames very easily in Wireshark? That was a challenge for me. How to compare two frames in Wireshark very quick? Whew. And hash? Yeah, there is one value, but you only know there is different, but you don't know the differences. Yes, there's one way. You can use it on the command line and export the output as a JSON file, and then you grab the two JSONs. And then you got it. This is a feature I'm missing sometimes in Wireshark to compare frame 10 and 11. What's the difference? So you can do it the boss way, yeah? Zero and ones. It costs too much time, yeah? For boss is okay, because boss is paying you, yeah? But for me, it's too long, yeah? Use export the output as JSON and grab or compare or make a diff on both outputs, yeah? And then you see the difference, yeah? Okay. So, with PGP, authentication and security, yeah? I got a talk during SharkFest also. Do you talk about PGP SEC? And I said, no, because you know what? From the top 100 providers, only three using PGP SEC right now. And they have a lot of issues. And it's very complicated right now, like with PKI or PKA infrastructure or public key infrastructure. It's not so easy. What I've going a level deeper, I would say, or lower, depends on the viewpoint, is how is that authentication used in PGP? And when I read that, I got an issue several years ago. Okay, you have a firewall in between the both PGP speaker, and you have to change something on your firewall. And I was thinking, but it has nothing to do with PGP. It has to do with TCP. Okay? So, coming back to my RFC, RFC for TCP, who knows it, the number? 793, yeah? It's the original RFC TCP, yeah? And the authentication is a TCP option and not a PGP value. So that means on layer 4, you have a TCP options. On layer 3, you have IP options. On layer 4, you have TCP option. And PGP with MD5 authentication use the layer 4 options, yeah, in the header. When you never saw that before, yeah, you configured it on a router, yeah, okay, neighbor, IP address, authentication, password, poof. And then, what's going on the wire? You have no clue. And when I captured that the first time, I was searching under PGP, yeah, because it's a part of PGP authentication, but it uses TCP options here. Yeah? And you can see it here as a decoding, yeah? And I was searching here on PGP and not on TCP, yeah? So I collapsed TCP first and then expanded. Ah, there's the option, yeah? That was a key point for me when I troubleshoot that the first time, yeah? And you see it here, yeah? Yes?
So the
MD5
you need, it's a TCP option, right?
It's a TCP option, yeah.
So if you would like to reset the PGP session,
yes?
And you have the MD5 label, do you need it as well?
I'm not sure. I have no clue.
I
don't know. Yeah, no, I have no clue. For me, it was only surprising it that it's on the TCP. Layer, yeah, and not on the PGP dissection, yeah. That was for me configuring, for example, there was one vendor, yeah, configuring you have to change some TCP option. And I was thinking, what has TCP option to do with BGP? Yeah? Because when you have no capture, you don't know. That's a good question. I have a research maybe about that afterwards, yeah? So we can discuss afterwards. Thanks. A very good input, yeah? So there's also different kind of authentication. One authentication was with MD5. Okay, you know right now MD5 has a lot of collisions, yeah? Not so the best one anymore, yeah? And then there's also TCP authentication option, yeah? Or enhanced authentication option, yeah? But nobody used it. There was a Twitter post, I think, from this guy, from one vendor, okay, you see it from Cisco. He tweeted it. Nobody will use it, yeah? It's too much. Yeah? Lack of interest. Can happen. And then also, display filter expression here, TCP option kind, and then TCP And then you see, this is a predefined value of 29, yeah? So, and what else you can read here on the display filter expression? Okay, this is 1 byte. That means 1 byte, 8-bit, 256 options that can be represented, but not every bit is used, yeah, or every combination is used, yeah? Okay, you know something happens sometimes on the internet, yeah, with PGP, security, hijacking, whatever, yeah, happens every day. Because humans are doing some configuration of PGP, yeah? Some announce some prefixes. For example, the prefixes here with the 4.1. Who knows 4.1 right now? Or 4.9? You know all 4 times 8, yeah? 8.8, the DNS server of Google, yeah? When Cloudflare announced that, yeah? The 4.1. And I got one of the big network vendor, yeah? They have in the documentation used the 4.1 as for the wireless landing page when you redirect on your wireless LAN controller, yeah? Yeah, you mentioned it, yeah? Which vendor was it, yeah? And this has also happened with PGP, yeah? Some guy announced a prefix which other provider will use it, yeah? And then you have trouble. And from experience with PGP operators, it's not sometimes seemingly solved very quick, yeah? It needs sometimes 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, yeah? To solve it, yeah? It's not so easy, yeah? Okay, 2 bytes versus 4 bytes. Yeah, I put this Lego guys there, yeah? So 4 bytes here, 2 bytes there. Which one I will fight, yeah? But they can work together, yeah? Because they have the same helmet, yeah? They are guys from Sharks, yeah? Okay, there's one AS number, which is very important. This number, yeah? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. When you capture that, that is a hint for you. Okay, some guy is doing 2 bytes. The other guy is doing 4 bytes. And they have to interact here, yeah, with this AS number. It's not a private, but it's a special use case, yeah? Like 169.254.x.y, yeah? RFC, what was it? Let me check in my mind. RFC 3330, yeah? 3330, yeah? This is what Microsoft use it when they're not getting an IP address, yeah? Abiba called it sometimes, yeah? And this is also a very good number, yeah? You should take care when you're dealing with PGP, yeah? With 2 byte and 4 bytes, yeah? Because one guy is capable of 2 bytes and 4 bytes, and the other guy only 2 bytes, yeah? And what's happened when you make an open message with a 4 byte and this guy cannot understand the 4 bytes, yeah? Because they will expect a 2 byte, yeah? Something here also, yeah? Display filter expression. What are the capabilities here for example, support for 4-octet AS number. Yeah, it's an option. You send it in the open message. Yeah, I will support this, 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 and that. Yeah, and one of the options is I will support 4-byte. Yeah, and then also go with your mouse or your cursor. Yeah, over this field. Sometimes some info field will occur. Yeah, so you get also some information, and you see, okay, 1-byte. Yeah. Please use the display filter expression very intensely. Yeah, I learned a lot with that. I can recommend it for you to extend your protocol knowledge also. Yeah, RFC reading. Yeah, it depends. Yeah, 1st April RFCs are funny. Yeah, but some RFCs are very dry. Yeah. Here we got a decode of that. Yeah, and you see, okay, my AS number. And the whole time, this is another point I found out after dealing it with some virtualization stuff right now. This the vendor A and vendor B, you called it one with M and the other one with Y. Yeah? So you have different virtualization platform, network virtualization right now. Yeah, and then you use some fancy stuff. Yeah, one vendor called it with A, other with N. Yeah, whatever. And then you found out this hold timer, vendor A used another hold timer than vendor B, and how they match, yeah? Basic things, yeah? But got some issue, yeah? And the recommendation, what about hold timer, yeah? The default hold timer from RFC or the default hold timer the operating system will use it, yeah? And then you have other capabilities, yeah? Have a look on this trace file, search about it, and then you can look what are the capabilities, for example, yeah? Four octet also here in the pass attribute. It's also another parameter in PGP, and you can find it. When Wireshark was set it up initially with the PGP dissector, it supports only 2-byte, yeah? And when 4-byte erases, these guys, the developers, thanks to the developers, they adapt it very quickly and have to extend all the code for the 4-byte, yeah? Where it can arise, yeah? You can show on the dissector, yeah? There's also some bugs when they mixed. And what the good thing about a bug is, when the submitter of the bug spent the time to submit a trace file. And the trace file, you can download it for your research. And you can see, okay, what's wrong, what's right, yeah? For example, when you search about this bug ID, yeah? I'm not sure, is that a trace file there or not? Please, internet is working right now or slowly again? Working? Can you search about it? Is there a trace file attached or not? And this is also a recommendation which I got from the developers, yeah? Every time when you open a bug on wireshark.org, yeah? Please submit a trace file. Because of these developers, yeah? They are not protocol geeks, yeah? They are coding geeks, yeah? And when they have a trace file, they can see, okay, this is wrong, this can be right, or whatever, yeah? So you found it? Is a trace file there? Yes, no? Yes, public attachment. There's a trace file on this case, yeah? And I can encourage you, please submit a trace file for every bug you open on wireshark.org, yeah? This is also for learning, yeah? You can download this trace file and see the difference, yeah? On your installation, whatever, yeah? Though, and here, in the decode, you leave this number, yeah? AS_trans, yeah? With the 2-byte and 4-byte, and then you see this byte here in the hex decode, it's 4-byte, yeah? Because this value here in the original standard or publication of the PGP specification has only a value of 2-byte, yeah? And then you need to switch, okay, I'm capable of a 4-byte, and I put it my 4-byte ASN number here in this value, yeah? So this is the meaning with this transformation. I called it sometimes. It's wrong, but it's other word for that. Yeah. Okay, communities. Yeah, this Shark guys, because I tried to put some of this guy there, because you are not falling into sleep. Yeah. Community, you can read it on the dissector, yeah? You know how to download the dissector right now? Who found it out? Who read it right now? No? I will show you. So Wireshark.org, then go to develop, browser code. Oops, I'm offline maybe. Let me check. Yes, I'm offline. So, again. Develop, browser code, and then comes the magic. I have to learn it, I think, after several SharkFest. Who are the dissectors? Yeah. You know what that means, the IBAN directory? I got that information from Gerald one time. I was, bling! What does that mean, IBAN? Israel or Ethernet, yeah, I think it comes from Israel, I'm not sure, yeah, but it was Israel or Ethernet protocol analyzer network. And you have to find it out, yeah. That was the magic, yeah, for me. Ah, this dissector's here in the IBAN directory, okay. And then going there, dissectors, and then you find, okay, a lot of them. And here is the packet dash pgp.c, yeah? And then you can open it, or you can look online, yeah? And then you see on the history, I was surprised in the morning when I checked that. Come on, slowly, yeah? That was modified by Guy Harris last time, yeah? And for example, Uli Heilmeier, is that there? No, it's not there. You can touch into people directly here, the developers, yeah? For example, Alexis, yeah? Who's Alexis, over there? No, not there. All these guys behind the next door, yeah? You can go into touch with these guys, yeah, when you have some issue, yeah? They are not zombies, yeah? Not aliens, yeah? They are real persons, yeah? Go there, have a meeting, have a talk, whatever, yeah? When something is wrong on the dissector, I encourage you, go into contact. And this is the spirit of SharkFest, yeah? And I think you will agree, or? You can go directly to talk. Like, I go to Sake, yeah? We have a talk about something, yeah? Or I go to Hansang, or Jasper, or whatever, yeah? This is the spirit of SharkFest, yeah? And I will encourage you to do it also, yeah? And I see a lot of faces coming from year to SharkFest, yeah? Half, I would say, a few guys I know, yeah? This guy from the background was last year in my timing session, yeah? I remember you, yeah? Okay, coming back. Okay, Iana, yeah? Another source of information, yeah? And all this value defined, very good, yeah? Extended communities. When you troubleshoot an MPLS network, for example, yeah? You configured it on a router. Please use extended communities for send and receive route target. When I configured it on a router, yeah, not thinking about. And then captured later on, yeah? I spoke with this guy during lunch. I say, I made the wrong way, yeah? I learned how to configure it on a router, but I not understand how it looks like on the wire, yeah? You should using capture every day, yeah? Because when you capture it, you can see it. Sniff it and you can see it was one of the statements, yeah? It's not so easy anymore right now because everything is virtualized in the cloud, wherever, yeah? To getting the right capture file at the right point at the right time, yeah? It's a challenge, yeah? I know it, yeah? And there's also a bug again, yeah? See it? That something of the route type incorrectly displayed, yeah? Maybe there's a capture file too, and you can have a look there, yeah? Another thing about communities is how to extend it, yeah? Making large communities. And you see this value here, yeah? It's very large. 32? When I'm wrong, I think it's 32, yeah? 4 billion, because the German guys say milliarden, not billion, yeah? The English guy or UK or US guy say billion, million, K, and once, yeah? But it's the power, yeah? For me, this, it's easy to remember sometimes, yeah? Okay, I have 4, 294. I should remember this value, yeah? Because it's 295, okay? I make a bridge in my head, 294, 295, four values, something like that, yeah? You can impress your colleagues, yeah? Oh, 2^32, because 2^16 is easy, yeah? 65K or 64K, yeah? 65536, yeah? Doing a bit math in your mind also, yeah? It's good sometimes, yeah? For Wireshark, it's essential, I would say, because when you switch from the hex view to the bit view, yeah? And when you got the golden bit, you're the king of the star, yeah? Okay, coming back, BGP, load balancing, also something about, there's a use case for that, yeah? With extended community, yeah? ECMP, you know, oh, what is ECMP? Equal cost, multipassing, yeah? It's right now the techniques, every network in a redundancy way works, yeah? You're using all the passes, yeah? And not only the primary pass, and forgot the backup pass, yeah? This is also I found out when troubleshooting some network issue, yeah? They always test on the primary pass. Sometimes they forgot to switch over to the backup pass. For example, quality of service, they test it on the primary pass every time. Speed on primary pass, and then forgot it, oh, when we switch to backup pass, our cross and our voice works better than on the primary pass. I got one time the feedback from customer. They, what? On the backup pass? You got better voice quality than on the primary pass? You never tested, oh? Yes, we never tested. Okay, good. When you're in the field, you learn a lot, yeah? Sometimes challenging, but it's good, yeah? And here, all of this equal cost multipassing, load balancing, there's with layer 2 source address, destination address, whatever. It's one usage of PGP, yeah, with extended or large communities, yeah. This value, I was impressed. You know why? Why? You smelling in the background? The number, yeah? This number stands for? The beast. The beast? Okay. Where you use this beast always when you make a trace route? Who knows? Who? I can see a Mac. You have a Mac, yeah? Mac? Windows? Or X64? Or X68? The difference of trace route, yeah? On a Windows system, and the trace route on a Unix system. The first packet, yeah, is in UDP Echo on a Unix system, and then you have to put it in the port number And you know the port number is 2 of the power of 16. I mentioned that before. 65536 divided by 2, 32, plus this offset of 666. And then you have your starting port of the trace route, 34334, something like that, yeah? When you do it on a router, a Cisco router, yeah? You make an extended trace route that is using here all of this beast, yeah? And what I learned from that, who have heard about this TCP IP drinking game? I'm not drinking too much, but when I drink, very seldom, but then much. Who have heard about this TCP IP drinking game? So you guys have internet? Put it in your favorite search engine, Google or whatever. TCP IP drinking game. You can learn a lot of them, yeah? Have you heard about that?
Sure.
You should? Okay, have a look, yeah? TCP IP drinking game. It's very good because, like you guys, yeah? Sitting together, drinking something. Okay, what are these RFC? What are this protocol value? What is this protocol? What they interact, whatever, yeah? TCP IP drinking game. When you're going back from SharkFest, yeah? Have a look on TCP IP drinking game and you will have a lot of fun, yeah? Trust me. Okay. So, save the sharks, eat pork, yeah? That was funny. But we are speaking about PGPLS and not the sharks, yeah? That is for link signaling, yeah? Or link state signaling or link state distribution with IGP, OSPF version 2 or 3, yeah? Or ISIS, yeah? I spoke to one developer this week also, yeah? He told me, yeah, this ISIS dissector, yeah, have some improvement need to be done, yeah? Because some fields are not defined and whatever, yeah? But, you know, I said, yeah, I know. But PGP link state is operating or working together with this IGP, OSPF, and ISIS and make some information from this IGP protocols, like OSPF, and putting into PGP. Has nothing to do with redistribution. When I learned that, okay, how can you redistribute from one routing domain to another routing domain, using on the left side an IGP, on the other side you use BGP, and you bring the information or the prefixes from this side to the other side, yeah? But this interact, these two protocols, BGP with IGP, yeah? And put it into PGP. And there's also some information, yeah, with link state distribution, because this is important in data center networks. For example, Microsoft or VMware, whatever, using some IGP or SPF, yeah? They support it, I don't know right now, in NSX they supported ISIS, not anymore, but OSPF, yeah? And then you can interact with PGP, yeah? Or another thing is, who have heard about this ONOS project? Software-defined networking. I was this year on a conference in the US. They called it software-defined hardware. I was crazy. What the fuck? Software-defined hardware? Okay, can do it, yeah? But here, software-defined networking, yeah? The SDN controller. This is the way that works right now because actual networking stuff, yeah? Going from traditional networks to controller-based networks. Every vendor named it different, yeah? There's one revolution right now, in my opinion, and I'm missing a session here on SharkFest, the software-defined wide area networks. This is where right now every vendor has this buzzword, software-defined wide area network, yeah? How they interact, how they work, or sometimes software-defined local area network, or software-defined access, or whatever it's called, yeah? Each vendor name it a bit different, yeah? I call it every time, it's a fabric, yeah? It's the best word. Call it a fabric and you're happy, yeah? Okay, coming back. With this link state, you have this address family identifier, and the sub-address family identifier to define which information you carry with BGP. It can be a MAC address here, and I was surprised when I prepared this talk, I presented that in last SharkFest in the US. I was crazy because 2 years ago I made a session about layer 2 stuff, yeah, like LSCP, Link Aggregation Control Protocol. And what I found right now out, I will show you later on, in real world data center networks, yeah, Link Aggregation Control Protocol is a layer 2 control protocol, is the inside of BGP. When I saw that the first time, it was crazy, yeah? Why is LSCP part of BGP right now? And then I got in hind in real world data center network when the server is dual homed because the network topology changed right now from core distribution access to spine and leaf design. We have heard about spine leaf design right now? Some? A few, yeah? And then you have your server connected dual homed. And the server have link aggregation to two leaf switches, yeah? And the leaf switches interact with the spine with PGP. Different vendor. It can be Juniper, can be Arista, can be Cisco, ACI, whatever, yeah? They're standards, yeah? Or Alcatel-Lucent, I will show you, yeah? In the backend-bgp.c, you find a lot of information on comments, yeah? How the link state should be and so on, yeah? Have a look. When you open the source code, you can find it also, yeah? A lot of comments there. Have a look, yeah? Okay, link state. Here you see it. Address family identifier and sub-address family identifier. Okay. NLRI. Next layer reachable information, yeah? This is very important, yeah? Here you see link state inside of PGP of the pass attribute, yeah? So that means from your OSPF database, some information of the link state is being copied into PGP. This is not redistribution, yeah? It's copy information from one routing domain to the other routing domain, but using the protocol PGP, yeah? And then you have node attributes and link attributes with type length value and so on, yeah? Although bugs, you can find something with link state, yeah? When you're interested, have a look on these two bugs. Some capture files are there. Very good, yeah? Okay, additionally pass, I think I will go quick because of time. Some nodes also in the dissector there, yeah? You can find it, what's happened there. And then you see it, layer 2 VPN, yeah? And then eVPN. And this is also a very good thing, yeah? Send and receive. Is that I called it sometimes full duplex, half duplex, and non-duplex, yeah? Not speaking, only listening, only sending, and both ways, yeah? And I found out sometimes I have some issues also there with different vendors, yeah? Okay, some errors also, and some flapping, yeah? You're setting up a connection to a peering partner, and then flaps, going up, going down, going up, going down, oscillating, whatever, yeah? Also sometimes, yeah, when some parameters are not supported, yeah? And you've got the whole routing information or the prefix information from your partner, and on the end of the frame, okay, reset or whatever, yeah? Have a look there, yeah? Because I know it's not so easy and nowadays to have everywhere a capture point, yeah? Sometimes right now, all this, I would call it internet working system, supported capturing, yeah? Okay, eVPN for data center and data center interconnect service provider. This one here is very important, yeah? MAC mobility. Right now, you have data center networks with an overlay and an underlay, yeah? So all these buzzwords coming in, VXLAN, whatever, yeah, OTV, EVPN, PGP, or Fabric, QFabric, whatever, yeah, different vendor, different names, yeah. And this PGP, EVPN, I would think this is a solution right now that will survive, yeah, from different vendors and not vendor dependent, yeah. And then you have something what you have announced, yeah. All these words here and this RFC define something, but not everything, yeah. Only four values or five values, and the sixth value is missing, for example, yeah. This is right now up to date with the spine leaf design and the host, yeah. And you see the host there are connected here single, yeah. What's happened when the host is connected dual to this leaf, yeah. You have a port channel or not, yeah, and how the port channel is signaled to the other guy, yeah, because the port channel needs two partner, a link partner, yeah. That's here, this way, yeah. And then you have to deal with these words, yeah. And this is from different vendors right now supported, yeah. I'm not sure, the RFC is not finished sometimes, some drafts are there. But I was crazy when I saw it, yeah, LSCP inside of PGP, yeah. 2 years ago, I was talking LSCP in a physical world, yeah, how to capture it and what are the challenges to capture it, yeah. And then you see here, although PGP point EVPN, next layer, reachability information, route type, and then you have your value, yeah. And when you click here, it's 4. When you click there, it's 1 or 2, yeah. So you can learn if this dissector is working correctly or not, yeah. There's also some capture files you can look at, yeah. And then coming back, or the last topic is graceful restart, yeah, with PGP. Also a fancy feature. But it depends how vendor A and vendor B or vendor C or vendor D are implemented it, yeah. And I found out sometimes it works not very well between different vendors, yeah. And the point is how long to wait, because sometimes I will show you the slide on, yeah, here. See what's happened, yeah. I compared two frames and I checked, okay, make a diff. Ah, this is the difference between vendor A and vendor B. This one put some bits or bytes more in it, and you see, okay, there's a restart timer, there's the same, yeah. And then the pre-serve forwarding state to have a look. And there's also a bug here where you can find some information on it.
Oops, sorry.
Another thing for flow specification, yeah. This two bugs ID. So use bug.wireshark.org or bugswireshark.org, yeah, as also a research source, yeah. Okay, and this is maybe the next step. I heard that quick also this time on every SharkFest, yeah? And I found it funny, yeah? Some guy found it also funny right now, because this is the way, yeah? Right now they're talking about HTTP/version 3, yeah? Have you heard about that? When not, I think some guys will talk about quick also here on SharkFest. Everything over HTTP, also PGP. It's only a TCP session, yeah? You can mention that, but this TCP session can be more complicated, yeah? And I hope you liked the journey the last few minutes, because this one, I think you mentioned that, yeah? The battleship, when network engineers get boring, yeah? They play battleship over PGP with the communities, yeah? They set it up to PGP router, and they make a battleship and signaling it which field hit and not a hit, yeah? That was in May when I presented, and you see it, yeah? You can do that also with PGP, yeah? So this protocol is very powerful, I would say. Keep that in mind. And this protocol supported you to have access to the internet right now and long days ago, yeah? PGP is the de facto internet routing protocol, yeah? But internet is one thing, corporate networks, home networks, whatever, it's another thing, yeah. Okay. Thanks for your attendance. Thanks for the questions. There was one good comment, some good Heinz order for me. Please provide session feedback because Janice punished me every time, yeah? You heard that in the morning, yeah? Who had installed the guidebook app right now? More hands, please. You should install it. I remember you because Janice told me, please remember this guy, guidebook app on Android, on iOS, to provide feedback, yeah? When something was wrong, when you say totally disappointed, don't write it down, yeah? Okay, otherwise, thank you, yeah?